Okay, well, let's pray and get started. Father, thank you for the privilege of being here. I thank you for your word, which is a light to our feet and a lamp to our path. And I thank you for the way in which it reveals to us who you are and who your Son is through the ministry of your Spirit. So tonight, as we have this special opportunity to look at this great part of God's Word, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, you who are our rock and our Redeemer. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. I have a good friend who used to do children's ministries all over. He would go in for church for a week and run a program, and he had puppets that he used. He actually later served on the church staff with me up in Canada. And I still remember one of them when he was at the church that I was pastoring, and he had, it was a parents' night, I think, and he did something, and it was a simple little thing, but it caught my attention because it was probably aimed at about my level, about 6-year-old or 5-year-old. But it was all about the puppets trying to put their shirt on and their sweater on. And it all depended on a very simple principle that you could never get the buttons to match if you didn't get the first one right. If you didn't get the first one right, you were never going to get any of the rest of them right. And you couldn't get it to turn out that way. I mean, nothing is simpler than that. And yet, on another level, nothing is more important than that. If you don't get the first thing in the right place, then nothing else is going to be in the right place. And that's profoundly true when you think about the Bible, and you think about God, and you think about understanding all of these things related to Him. If you don't get the first thing in the right place, then nothing is going to fit together. And the central definition is a simple 3-word definition about what Christianity is. A book written years ago by a man named Griffith Thomas simply said it: Christianity is Christ. And if you're not right about Christ, you're not going to get anything else in the right place. And if you get that wrong, nothing is going to fit together. That was Paul's great concern for the Colossian Christians. And we're studying the book of Colossians together on these nights. They were a church he'd never visited. He'd never met most of the people who were there. He knew about them through the man who had planted the church, a man named Epaphras. And they had started well in their Christian life. God was blessing. God was working. But then some people had come in and we're pressing them in certain ideas, all kinds of various ideas, a kind of stir fry of the various religious ideas of their community. The community was partly Jewish, partly Gentile, partly Roman, native Phrygians in the center of Turkey where they came from. And then the Greeks and the Romans had moved into the area. So there was this stir fry of ideas that they were being presented with. And what Paul is simply saying to them is, understand who Christ is, and you'll be able to pick your way through all the rest of this stuff. But if you don't get right about Him, then nothing is going to make sense. And so, as he's writing, he begins his letter with a normal kind of greeting, and then he does what he normally does. He gives God thanks, and then he prays for them. And as he prays for them, he comes to one of the great passages in the New Testament. In terms of describing who Christ is and stretching our mind to get our mind around Him. And that's where we are tonight. So, if you're visiting with us or are new with us, we are in Colossians chapter 1. We're going to be looking at verses 15 to 20 tonight. But as I pointed out last week, in Paul's typical way, from verse 9 to verse 20, in the Greek language, is one long, very involved, very complicated sentence. We can't write sentences that long in English. It just doesn't work. But in Greek, there's a way in which you can do it. And so I want to begin reading, picking up in the middle of the sentence, but in verse 12. But we're going to begin focusing on verse 15. But I just want, giving thanks, he's saying this is the mark of a person who's walking in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, to go back to verse 9 or 10. And then in verse 12, giving thanks to the Father, who's qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light, who has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption through the forgiveness of sins. So beginning at verse 13, he has pushed Jesus right to the center of things. What's happened in your life that you need to give God thanks for? You have been, verse 12, qualified to have a share in the inheritance of God's people. And that happens because God has rescued you from the domain of darkness, where you were before you met Christ, and transferred you, given you a new citizenship in the kingdom, as he puts it, of his beloved Son, very literally, the kingdom of the Son whom he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God. So really, in the original language, this isn't even a new sentence. It's all tying back in to say why it is we can be confident that he has delivered us and what it means to be in the kingdom of God's Son who's redeemed us. So, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him all things were created in heaven or in earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that in everything he might be preeminent, he might have first place. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether in earth or in heaven, making peace or having made peace by the blood of his cross. So let me just tell you where we're going. In verses 15 to 20, Paul is going to say three things about Christ and why he is supreme. So you'll notice it is all leading to the end of verse 18 when he says, so that in everything he will have first place. He is supreme because of his relationship to God. That's the first part of verse 15. He's supreme because of his relationship to creation. That's the second half of verse 15 on through verse 17. And he's supreme because of his place in the new creation, or the church, if you want. But the fundamental thing is here, talking about the creation, or the new creation, Jesus is supreme. But he begins in verse 15. By the way, I should just make an observation in passing that scholars debate whether this was a hymn that already existed in the early church community, and whether Paul is picking it up and he has put it into his letter. Some think maybe he wrote it as a hymn, and others think that he is just in a very poetic mood as he writes this, because this becomes kind of the highest level of writing that he does in all of his writings. On one level, it really doesn't matter. If it's a hymn, he's put it in because he agrees with it. So if it did exist somewhere beforehand, you know, if I'm speaking and I quote a hymn and say this is true, then you know that I agree with whatever I've just quoted. So I think he's writing it here. I think he just happens to be in a very full of gratitude to God and writes it in a very elevated kind of way. So let's just walk our way through it. We'll stop a couple of times just to make sure we're on track and getting some questions, and there's lots of questions that are probed by this. But I do want to remind you again that we're following a connection, and in a few minutes you'll see that that's important. Going back to verse 13, just to get that flow, which is again jumping in the middle of something, that he's rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear son, or of the son whom he loves, who, and now it changes, who redeemed us. In whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God. So he shifted from God as the subject. God rescued us. God transferred us to now Christ, who Christ is. Christ is the image of the invisible God. That's the statement about his relationship to God. What does it mean that Jesus is the image of the invisible God? I have to think about the word image for a little bit and just try to understand what he's saying. The word image is a stronger word than just likeness, for example. The word likeness in the Greek language can refer to a resemblance that's accidental. Every now and then, probably you're in this position. Somebody say, you just remind me of so-and-so. And people have said on several occasions, you remind me of a particular actor who I particularly have distaste for. I just can't stand the man, and I never view that as a compliment, and I refuse to see any similarities between the two, and I'll leave it for you to figure out who that might be. I prefer to be thought of as remarkably handsome, like some, anyway. But many of us have that kind of, you remind me of so forth, and that resemblance is accidental. There's no connection, there's just we remind somebody of something. But there's an intentional likeness. An image, the word image, is a word that has about it the idea of an intentional likeness. It was used for example, the head of the emperor on a coin. Or it was used more significantly of when you took a stamp and you used a stamp and die, and there would be an intimate connection between what you were stamping or what you were molding and what was produced. And in using this expression, Paul is telling us that Jesus is the image of God, in that he gives us a likeness of him, which goes beyond merely accidental, which is, in this case, an exact likeness. Now, think about that expression. Who is the image of the invisible God? On one level, when we think of image, we think about human beings made in the image of God. And going back to Genesis chapter 1, God says we will make them in our own image. Now, there's a difference between being in the image of God and being said to be the image of God. To be in the image of God means there is a correlation, that something about who we are corresponds to who God is. But Christ is said to be the image of God. And Paul uses that term again in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4 when he speaks about Christ, who is the image of God. So twice he uses that, and he has about it the idea of an exact likeness. So what he wants us to say, and he reinforces this later, so you'll notice when we get to verse 19, it says, using the translation that I use tonight, in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And he repeats that again, and actually goes a little bit further in chapter 2 and verse 9 when he says, in him dwells all the fullness of the divine nature in bodily form. So, what he's saying here is something about God being perfectly represented by who Jesus is, and connected to that is the idea that Jesus is the visible representation of the invisible God. Because, as the New Testament says, John chapter 1, verse 18, no one has seen God at any time. Clearly, there's in the Old Testament stories of people seeing visions of God, but no one has seen God in his essence at any time. Paul in Romans talks about the same thing, the invisible God. Even though his attributes were seen, he himself is invisible. And then we're told in 1 Timothy the same thing, that God, and several times in the Bible, that God has no physical form, but Jesus is the invisible God made visible. Now, we have to give this, obviously, some significant thought, because Paul is telling us that Jesus bears a resemblance and a likeness to God. That means he and he alone can be described as being in the, as the image of God. And the very next thing that he's going to tell us about is that he does the works that only God does, because only God creates. So he is making a claim here that the reason that he represents God is because he is God. He doesn't say it in quite that way, but the New Testament pushes us constantly in that direction. For example, the Gospel of John begins with, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Same was in the beginning with God. Or Jesus will say, and immediately he got a reaction, "Before Abraham was, I am," in John 8 and verse 58. Or it will say in Romans chapter 9, this is one that always strikes me as I think about it. It is a benediction kind of statement, but he writes, as he says, "To them," that is the Jewish people, "belong the patriarchs, and from their race, according to the flesh, is Jesus, who is God over all, blessed forever." So Paul is wanting these people to understand that the one of whom he is speaking, the one who they have trusted, the one whom they have followed, whatever these false teachers will say, because what they're teaching is Jesus is important and Jesus is significant, but he's not sufficient and he's not supreme. You need more. And Jesus wants them, Paul wants them to understand, you can't have more than the image of God. So that's his first thing. He is the image of the invisible God. Now, moving right into the next part, he now begins to talk about his relationship to creation. And the very next phrase kind of takes us back a little bit, because if we've been following that first statement, then he says, he is the firstborn of all creation. How can he be the image of God and the firstborn of all creation at one and the same time? Well, part of the issue here is the Greek word that Paul uses. And we talked about this at one of the earlier sessions, but let me just walk through it again. The Greek word, if you take it in its kind of original and root meaning, means firstborn. Pretty straightforward. Luke chapter 2, verse 7. Mary brought forth her firstborn son, and as I say, put him in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger, is how I remember the rest of it going. And that is used in, the same word is used in the book of Hebrews in chapter 11 when it talks about Pharaoh killing the firstborn. So it has that literal sense, but it also had another sense. It had the sense not only of first in birth order, but first in rank, first in importance. And it came from the cultural recognition that the firstborn son was the one who represented the father. And as the oldest son, he was the most important son in the family. He was first, not just in time, but in rank. And so it came to be used for first in birth order, first in rank. Many times those two went together, but not necessarily. Now, behind it, there's something else going on here. Remember what we said back in verse 13? Remember what's said there? He rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son whom he loves. Now, if you listen very carefully to that, you'll hear two words that are interesting: Son and kingdom. And he's talking about Jesus as a son who has a kingdom. Now, for us, that doesn't have much meaning. But for someone who is alert to the Old Testament and a Jewish person, that would send all kinds of bells off. The Son, who's a Son of God who has a kingdom. Well, turn with me to, we'll go the shorthand rule. Let's go to Psalm 89. Psalm 89 is a psalm about God's gift to Israel of a king of the line of David. You know the story in 2 Samuel chapter 7 that David says to Nathan the prophet, I'm going to build a house for God. It's not right that I'm dwelling in this beautiful palace and he's in a tent, so I'm going to build him a house. And Nathan says, that's great, go and do it. And then he goes home, lies down in his bed, and the Lord says to him, Nathan, you've got to go back to David and tell him he's not to build that house. He's a man of war, he's not going to build that house. But I'm going to do something for David. I'm going to build him a house. His son, after him, will sit on the throne. Now remember, David had come to the throne after Saul, wasn't related to him. And David is going to build a royal, God is going to build a royal house. It's interesting, it goes all the way back there, but even the English kings today, they still talk about, they're from the House of Windsor, and they talk about that family dynasty. Well, there's going to be a House of David, that is a royal dynasty. And God promises in chapter 7, verse 14 of 2 Samuel, that you will never lack a son to sit on the throne. I will be to him a father, and he will be to me a son. So that idea of a kingdom ruled over by someone who is my son. Now, all of that is to bring us to Psalm 89, because Psalm 89 is a psalm celebrating the Davidic covenant, the promise God made to David. For example, you can see it early on in verse 3 of Psalm 89. You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David my servant. I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. And then he talks about all of the other things that God has done as a blessing. And then verse 17, for you are the glory of their strength, by your favor our horn is exalted. Who's the horn? For our shield belongs to the Lord, our King, to the Holy One of Israel. So he's saying, the great gift is you've given us a king. And he's going back to what he'd said earlier. And then there's, of old you spoke in a vision to your godly one, meaning Nathan, David, I have granted help to one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found David my servant. With my holy oil I have anointed him, so that my hand shall be established with him. And then he talks about all of the blessings that he is going to give to David, to the Davidic king. Verse 26, he shall cry to me, you are my father, my God, the rock of my salvation, and I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his offspring forever, and his throne as the days of the heavens. And then it goes on to talk about some of the other parts here, and it keeps running back to this. And here's the great question in verse 49. Lord, where is your steadfast love of old, which by your faithfulness you swore to David? Israel at that time didn't have a king on the throne. Anyway, we can't go into all of that history. But what I want you to notice is that these ideas of a kingdom and a king who is some special way designated the Son of God, who is known as the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. Now you can see, I think, if you think about that verse, he is my firstborn. That has nothing to do with physical birth, first one born. David wasn't certainly the first king that ever existed. All kinds of kings before him. But he was the one to whom God gave, let's put it this way, firstborn rights. Okay, so the idea of firstborn is someone who has special place, who has firstborn rights, who has the highest of ranks. Same expression is used in a little bit different way back in the book of Exodus when it says in chapter 4 that Israel, you are my firstborn of all of the nations. Well, that's not first in birth order. That's first in rank. Have I lost you here? So when this statement means in this context, and it occurs elsewhere in the New Testament, the idea of firstborn has about it often, not always, and we're going to see it a little bit differently just in a few verses down, not first in time, but first in importance. But it also has the idea of someone who has firstborn rights, because the firstborn had the right to inherit and the right to represent the father. So when he says you are the firstborn, or he is the firstborn of all creation, especially in this context, remember the very next verses are going to say he made everything, and he's before everything that's made, and in him dwells all the fullness of the divine nature in bodily form. It's clear that he doesn't mean you are the firstborn of creation, but he means you are the firstborn, or you have firstborn rights over creation. You are God's heir to all things. So, this is, in fact, a strong statement of the authority and power of Jesus. Now, you know, stop me here to see if you've got any questions or things that you want to puzzle with me through.
Is Philippians 2 saying the same thing?
Well, it's certainly talking about the glory of Christ when it says, though he was by very nature God. Is that what you're thinking of? He did not consider equality with God something to be grasped for his own importance.
God exalted him above and gave him
the kingdom. So, and that's right, you have the kingdom there at the end. So, and there's another passage. I was working in this passage because next week we've got to be in Michigan and speak on it to a group there. So turn with me over to Hebrews chapter 1, because in some ways this comes close to the same kind of statement. Hebrews chapter 1. Long ago, and actually that means just simply in the past, many times and in many ways God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he's spoken to us in his Son. So again, now we have the Son language, but notice what's said about him, whom he appointed the heir of all things. So he has firstborn rights to all things, through whom he created the world. He is, and here's the statement, the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. So the writer of Hebrews is telling us that Jesus is in the image of God, that he has the exact imprint of his nature, and he is the radiance, picture of something that's shining and bright, of his glory. Which again reminds us of what John said in John chapter 1, verse 14, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the one and only of the Father, full of grace and truth. But it also, in Ephesians, is saying, and he is the heir of all things. So as the first of all creation, he is the ruler. He is the one who has firstborn rights. It's all made by him. And now he's going to come back, and you're going to have to excuse me here for being pedantic, but sometimes it's fun, even if it seems a little bit... Okay, so verse 16. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. Now, you'll notice three expressions: by him, through him, for him. The first one is literally, in him all things were created. And I think that's the way it should be translated here, and I happen to agree with most commentators on that, so I'm not sure why the translators made the choice. If you look at the margin or the note, it makes the other comment, in, which is the usual way of translating it. In him, all things were created. We'll look at the rest of it in just a minute. Through him, or by him, all things were created, and for him, all things were created. Now, as you begin to think about that, you begin to realize that that first one, which is the one in him, all things were created, is the one that it's worth thinking about. The other two are fairly, through him all things were created, for him all things were created. But before anything exists, you plan a building. It first exists in someone. If it doesn't exist in them, it can never be made by them, right? I mean, it has to be designed. And when he says all things were made in him, I think that that's saying that Jesus is the designer of creation. That all of those things that are so amazing and marvelous about creation were designed in the mind of Jesus. And he is God's agent, so they were created through him, and they were created for him. Now, I would never have done this, but my father, when I was very young, 6 or 7 years of age, designed a house, was the contractor, and acted as the general contractor through which it was built, and it was built for him. He was the designer, he was the builder, and he was the owner. And in a very small way, some of you are quite capable of that, that's what he's saying. What's Jesus' relationship to creation? It was created in him. And so, as you think about all of the things that amaze you about this, and we've got the whole intelligent design movement that goes on, and however you want to get into that, and as you think of that, it's interesting to think about that's the fingerprints of Jesus. Now, in some mysterious way, the whole Trinity was involved in this. I don't want to try to parcel out, but I'm just telling you what Paul is saying here. He's saying, in him all things were created, and by him all things were created. That may remind you of John chapter 1. Remember, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him, not a single thing came into being apart from him. So he is the agent of God's creation. That's what we read earlier in In Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 2, it says that God has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he made the worlds. So, that's clear. And then, for him. There's a famous quotation by a man who was a great theologian in Holland and also became the prime minister of that country, started a university and so forth. His name was Abraham Kuyper. And he said, there is not a single square inch of the universe over which Jesus Christ cannot say, mine. And that's what Paul wants these Colossians to understand. So notice again, let's go back to that. In him all things were created. Heaven, meaning the stellar creation, and on earth, visible or invisible. And because these people were impressed by angelic beings and ultimately by the dark powers, he says, whether rulers or dominions or powers or authorities, which are all names of angelic beings. Sometimes it's used of good angels, sometimes it's used of fallen angels. But he is making it very clear, no creature exists apart from Christ. Now, he's not here explaining presence of evil. He's not trying to explain how rulers and authorities can be the ones whom he had to defeat on the cross. That's going to come up in chapter 2. But his point is, in the ultimate sense, all things were made by him. We might as well press on to the next two and finish up what's said. And he is before all things. Before, in the sense of in time. So if you're before created things, you stand outside created things, right? He is before all things. Before him, there were no created things. Which is to say, not only that he's pre-existent, but that he is, in one sense, uncreated, and therefore eternal, pre-existent, eternal, the maker of all things. It sounds remarkably like God himself. And then he says in this last statement, and in him, how's it translated? It says, in him all things hold together. All things stick together. Which is saying that the principle of cohesion in the universe is not impersonal forces of nature, it is the presence of God. In Hebrews, it's put this way, he bears along or he upholds all things by his powerful word. So Jesus is not simply the creator, he is the sustainer of creation. And creation consists and holds together and continues because of that. So when Martin takes his telescope out and looks at the skies and looks at the stars, he needs to remember, as he always does, the words of Isaiah chapter 40, that he calls the stars by name. He can describe, according to scientific principles, how all those things are going to work. But if, speaking on another level, if Jesus took his hand off, that would collapse. This is not a deistic universe where God wound it up and left. He's saying that he is he is sustaining all things by the word of his power and carrying on and sustaining. So he is the sustainer, the upholder, the mover of the universe. Okay, so let's just pause there. What we've said is, because of his relationship to creation, he is, to God, he is supreme. He is the image of God. Because of his relationship to creation, He is supreme. He is, what have we said? First over all creation. So he is the heir of creation. He is creation's builder, designer, designer, builder, and owner. He is pre-existent before creation, and he's the sustainer of creation. Now, Paul would say, and he doesn't say it directly, but he says, why would you go somewhere else? Why would you worry about something else when you understand who Jesus is and what he's done? Anyway, let me stop here and hear questions, concerns, clarifications, whatever. Or have I put you all asleep,
is
Steve?
Is time a created thing?
I'm sorry?
Is time a created thing?
That's a great discussion of the theologian. And time and space, as we know it, are created things. But is there a consciousness of succession of events with God? It is another question. There's a phrase in the book of Revelation, which is translated in the King James Version, there shall be no more time. But almost certainly in that context, what that word means is there shall be no more delay. It doesn't mean there shall be no more time, answering the philosophical question of that. So I honestly don't know how to answer that, because I guess at some point I cannot conceive of God not understanding or not having succession of events. Things do not seem to me to be eternally present with him. So that implies some kind of time. So I'm sorry, I don't know. Certainly the way we experience time in this is part of the space-time continuum. I mean, my science isn't all that good, but clearly on that level it is. But if the larger question is there succession of events and consciousness of succession of events in heaven? It's certainly presented as if there is. I mean, the saints in heaven are asking how long, but I don't know what. You've got me. I don't know the answer.
Actually, it's saying exactly the same thing that you are, that it talks in the Bible about a day being as a thousand years. I mean, there are times, but his time is not the same in the way we count.
Yeah. I think that tends to be in a little bit different context about, you know, when it's quoting that of we want it now and God doesn't work according to our schedule. But anyway, it's a question that theologians are it's one of those ones that's a perpetual issue of the classic idea. And the Greek idea was that God was eternal and therefore outside any kind of consciousness of succession of events. But that's way above my pay grade here. I can't. Oh, the answer comes. Elizabeth.
Doesn't it say then the end will come, certainly in Daniel and then in 1 and 2 Thessalonians, day of the Lord? There's sort of endings to things, so would there be an ending so that heaven's going to be...
Well, you know, but we're talking about, I mean, when we're talking about space-time creation, clearly there's an end to that. And the Bible talks about there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells, which all makes it, but I can't conceive of infinity. I can't conceive of eternity. So I just don't know how that relates. And I think we're a long way from the text. Thank you, Steve, for helping us get way off into into that.
In him all things hold together in relationship to his being. Jesus was in the tomb.
Well, you know, we've got this, and the question was, in him all things hold together, and Jesus was in the tomb. The mystery of the God-man is perpetual for us, because Jesus did not cease to be omnipotent even when he was nailed to the cross. He did not cease to be omnipresent even when he was physically present on earth. He did not cease to be who he was when he was in the tomb. And of course, he was still alive. It wasn't as if he ceased to exist as a person. There's nothing of that in Scripture. Otherwise, he would have ceased to be God. The universe would have crumbled because the Trinity would no longer have existed. So the idea that physical death dissolved Jesus' being is contrary to logic. It's contrary to Scripture. I think that may be part of what you're thinking about. Dee?
It's interesting that Paul also identified Christ as the second Adam. So, in his concept, it almost looked like he was thinking of Christ as, you know, God creator, but also his humility as the second Adam. How did Paul kind of connect those things?
Well, I think and this is always the issue that we're working with, on what level is Paul thinking? Because there's the level of Christ's essential person and his incarnate. Hebrews isn't written by Paul, but it's an interesting thing, you know, because I spent all of today in with Colossians 1 and Hebrews chapter 1 and thinking about this. But in Hebrews chapter 1, just after the passage that we've read, it says that the Lord has given him a better name than the angels. And the rest of the chapter quotes 7 Old Testament passages to say he has a better name than the angels, 3 of them. He's got the name Son, he's got the name God, and he's got the name Lord, meaning Yahweh, as the Old Testament is quoted. But the very next chapter is he was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. And because his brothers were flesh and blood, he had to become like his brothers so that by death he might break him who had the power of death, that is the devil. He might set free those who all their lifetime were held in bondage, destroy the one who had the power of death, the devil. So on one level, you have the chapter 1, Son of God, Jesus, and then in chapter 2, you've got the lower than the angels one. In Jesus, we're going to have this imagery when we get to Colossians chapter 3. When it talks about putting off the old self and putting on the new self, I guess I'm thinking even more of the way it's put in Ephesians when it describes it. Of who we are in Christ, and he says we're to be renewed in the spirits of our mind and put on the new self created after the likeness of God and true righteousness and holiness. That's not the passage I'm wanting to find, but it talks about being renewed in the image, that God's renewing the image that we had in Adam, which is represented in Christ. So in that sense, he is the second Adam who's accomplishing what the first Adam didn't do, but he did it by taking our human nature and emptying himself of the free exercise of his royal divine attributes. I'm not answering your question very well. I apologize.
It's interesting how Paul thought he held both. He knew that God was in the flesh, but at the end of the chapter, he says, because he did that, he accomplished everything.
Hmm. Tara.
I just wondered, are there any references to the Lord or the Son holding together the earth in the Old Testament, and also for the Son? Being the creator as well.
Well, it doesn't, there's none that, well, it depends in terms of how you understand some of these passages. Again, to go back to Hebrews chapter 1, it says, you, Lord, quoting this about reference to Jesus, he's just quoted, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. Then he quotes, you, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth and the beginning and the work, heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. Like a robe, you will roll them up. Like a garment, they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years have no end. So there it speaks about him as the one who's sort of supervising creation. He brought it into being. They're like a garment before him. He's going to roll them up at some time. I mean, he's not absent and dismissed from all of that process. I don't know of any other passages in the Old Testament that are...
Yeah, my sister's Jewish, that's why I'm not.
Nikki.
The idea of in him all things were created and that being like him being the designer, is that connected to in him all things hold together?
Paul is, you know, always using that phrase about in him things are doing, but he, you know, the in him, by him gets pretty close together. But yeah, I think that there's that recognition that, I mean, there's a difference in picture. One is in him all things were created, but the point he's making when he says in him all things hold together is that he has not abandoned creation and just left it to run. He is sovereignly directing and, to use the words of Hebrews, carrying it along by his mighty word. It exists by his ongoing control of those things. It's why it always frustrates me. I understand why people talk that way, but they talk about Mother Nature, and it's not Mother Nature, it's the Lord Jesus who's sustaining all things, and nature is wonderful in the light of who God is. And we've got some students here who are looking through the microscope to look at the way in which things hold together. Those things come together in terms of how God's working. I can't remember where in the world who I was answering. Oh, it was Nikki. I'm sorry. Old age is a terrible thing. Okay, well then let's look. I'm talking a lot, but let's look at this last part of this section, that he is supreme because of his relationship to the church. So now he suddenly takes a different turn. He is the head of the body, the church. Now it's interesting because we're so familiar with that language that we can sometimes miss the point that it's not until you get to the book of Colossians, and it's not until you get the book of Ephesians, which are being written by Paul at the same time, that Paul uses that language. And he's talked about local churches as being a body. If you think of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and it talks about using the image of the body, and the public parts are not to be proud, well, the less public and the less obvious parts are being ignored. That's talking about a local church. But now he's talking about the church, the body of Christ, the universal church, the whole community. That becomes the theme in both Ephesians and in Colossians. And this is the first kind of major statement that Christ is the head of his body, the church. Now, clearly they didn't know all that we know about the brain. They didn't know all of those functions, but clearly they understood that the head directs the body, that the head is the authority over the body. And so part of it is headship, but the head is also the sustainer of the body. Chop off the head, the body doesn't function really effectively. So all of those come together to say that he is the one who gives life to the body. He is the one who directs the body. He is the one who empowers and enables how the body, the group of people, is going to exist. So now he's moved from the old creation, physical creation, to the new creation, the people of God. So he's the head of the body. Then he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that in all things he might have first place. The beginning, it's a Greek word. The word is arche, and it means beginning, It's the word that's in John chapter 1, verse 1. In the arche, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. But it also is a word that means the ruler, the authority. We have it in English in that way. So we use a lot of arche words, hierarchy, oligarchy. I mean, it's that's all that word. It means authority, rule, power. And so what does it mean when it says he is the beginning? It seems to have about it the idea that he is the founder. He is the source. He is the beginning, but he's also the beginning and the ruler. The church started, in other words, with Jesus. The firstborn from the dead, now firstborn, has more of a temporal thing. And so he's the firstborn from the dead as the first one who's raised from the dead and received his resurrection body. So he's not the first one raised from the dead in the sense of coming back from being dead. Lazarus, the widow's son, and Tabitha, three people Jesus raised from the dead, as well as, but none of them got a resurrection body. So Jesus is the firstborn from the dead in that sense, that as he is, we shall be too. And the whole point of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is, as we've borne the image of the earthly, Adam, going back to Dee's connection there to Adam, so we shall bear the image of the heavenly, meaning Christ in his resurrection body. So he is the firstborn from the dead. He is the promise, the pledge, that we will be raised as well, so that in everything, in the relationship to the church and in relationship to creation, so that in everything he might have first place. And you can hear him saying to these Colossian Christians, don't ever forget what God is doing. He's putting Christ at the center, and he's the one that you need to understand. That's God's purpose, that in everything he will have first place. He will have preeminence. So he's the head of the body. He's the beginning. He's the firstborn from the dead, so that in everything he might have preeminence. He is first in the church in every kind of way. Then we get to verse 19. And this could be translated, actually, our translators have helped us a little bit, because the text says one of two things. I'll quote it to you very literally. It says, for all fullness was pleased to dwell in him. Or, he pleased, meaning God pleased, all fullness to dwell in him. It doesn't define what the fullness is. Our translators, in my Bible, I'm not sure what your translation is, but in the English Standard Version, they've snuck in the word of God, all the fullness of God. It's not in the original translation. But it's in chapter 2, verse 9, where it says, in him dwells all the fullness of the divine nature in bodily form. So they're not wrong in wanting us to understand this is talking about the fullness of God. But it's interesting, he just says, in him all fullness was pleased to dwell. And in the next chapter he says, and that all fullness is all the fullness of God. I mean, you can't get any fuller than all the fullness of God. And it's interesting, he doesn't just say, in him fullness was pleased to dwell. It's all fullness. How do you get any fuller than all fullness? And it seems to be, because he comes back to the word fullness a number of times. He'll say, I quoted chapter 2, verse 9 earlier, in him dwells all the fullness of the divine nature in bodily form. And then the very next phrase is, and you're filled full in him. It seems to me that the Colossians were being told, yeah, you've got Jesus, but you don't have the fullness. And Paul wants them to say, no, if you've got Jesus, you have the fullness. You can't get fuller than all fullness. And you're filled full in him, but it's in him that all fullness is. So in him, it seems to me to be more likely that he writes, in him God pleased all fullness to dwell. And even people who believe it reads, in him all fullness was pleased to dwell, want to say, yeah, and he's talking about God's fullness. So we end up saying exactly the same thing. But then he goes on to say, and it's God's purpose to reconcile all things to himself, whether things, heaven, things on earth, having made peace through his death on the cross. Now we'll come back to this next time we come, because it leads into the next section. But the point he makes here, and it's going to come up when we get to verse 21, that reconciliation presupposes estrangement. You don't reconcile people who don't have any problems. Peacemaking presupposes enmity and anger. And that's the very next thing he's going to say in verse 21. That's our human condition. And God came as the reconciler, or Christ came as the reconciler, and he reconciled. And this sounds really, now think about where we've been. This sounds really weird. The image of God, the one who made all things, he reconciled through his death on a cross. Can you imagine how that sounded in Roman ears? You can't, because we're so used to the word cross. But it was illegal to use the word cross when you're talking to a Roman citizen. A Roman citizen couldn't be crucified. It was the unspeakable, it was the F word. Only they avoided it in our culture. It's a challenge to say it. But to think that you could have this huge picture of Jesus and then end the section by talking about death on a cross. How does that compute? How do you get from here to here? That he's the way, one who made all things, that in him all things hold together. He's the heir, he's the head, he's the... And he died on a cross. I mean, we read it and we understand that 1 Corinthians talks about the scandal of the cross. But we don't get it. I mean, it just doesn't register. It doesn't register for me. I mean, I know all this stuff, but to hear the conflict that's going on there, that this one became the one who died on a cross for the purpose of reconciling. And in the larger context of this book, and especially in the book of Ephesians, he reconciled in two directions. He reconciled us to God, and he reconciled humans to one another. And so in Ephesians, it's he made peace by the cross, breaking down the middle of the wall of partition that was between Jews and Gentiles, and made the two one in Christ. And it's the unity of the church, and he's reconciled us and done away with these boundaries that divide us apart. And he's working to reconcile all things in heaven on earth. There's a cosmic dimension to this, which raises a question that I'm not going to answer tonight, but I'll let you think about it. Does that imply then universal reconciliation? That everybody will ultimately be saved? Well, I'll let you struggle with that one for a while. Okay, we can deal with our questions. I want to be sensitive to time. Next week, we're going to take a break from going through Colossians in this direct way, so you can catch your breath, because I know I'm overloading you with all of this, but I'm having fun, even if you're not. And Elizabeth is going to kind of place the context of Paul's life so that Colossians sort of fits, and she's going to, is this a prophecy, or is it what is actually going to happen? She's going to try to just sort of do an overview of Paul's life and ministry, so we can see sort of where all of those things fit together. So, right? So, do we have any questions about this passage, about that last part that we looked at? So, yeah, that's obviously what it should do, is cause us to take our shoes off our feet and I recognize talking about the Lord, we're in holy ground. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive honor and glory and power and dominion, and not to leave us there. Okay, then, well, let's just do that. Let's pray and just give thanks to our Lord. Our Father, in the wonder of what it means that we pray to you as Father, given that privilege because you've qualified us for an inheritance of the saints in light, and you've rescued us from the domain of darkness and translate us into the kingdom of your Son, but we're also in the kingdom and the family of you, our Father. And we thank you that in him there's redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. We've tried in some small way to fill our minds with the thought that he is the image of you, the invisible God. Thank you that you've not left us to grope in the dark. Thank you for the affirmation of John that no one has seen you at any times, but he who is at your side, the one and only God, he is fully revealed, fully explained him. We thank you for your Son, who is the heir of all things, who will one day take possession and reign in undisputed rule, and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. We thank you that he not only made us and made the world, and he is before it, and it is for him, and he holds it together. But we thank you that when we rebelled, he came as the peacemaker, and through death on the cross, we who were far off have been made near by the blood of Christ. So we thank you for your Son, our Savior and Lord. And we give you great thanks. In his name, amen.